Yeah, so I'm here on behalf of the Living on Water project team. Four of us are based in Sewerk, in East Kilbride, in the Radio Carbon Lab. That's myself, Pete Jacobson, Derek Hamilton, and Gordon Cook. But we're also working with a much broader team, including folks at the Cranach Centre, Nick Dixon and Barry Andrian, who've been dining with us, and we've been in close contact with the rest of the Cranach Centre staff. We have Anne Crone of AOC Archaeology, who is doing dendrochronology for us as part of the project, the really key element of the project, which I'll speak about. And Jenny Miller, who is based at the University of Nottingham Trent, who is doing paleoenvironmental analysis, which I'll touch on as well. So just a quick background for those of you that may not know. It's a very familiar site in Perthshire, but Cranachs, what are they? I think at their core, at their simplest, the best way to define them is artificial island dwellings. You often see them like this, as sort of little rocky islets maybe with a few trees on. There are many, many more that are fully submerged in walks around the country. They have a very broad range of dates. There is now growing evidence for the Neolithic phase of Cranach building in Lewis. It is so far restricted to really Lewis and the Western Isles. And then they sort of seemingly re-emerge as a phenomenon in the early Iron Age, sometime between 800 and 400 BC, and then are used periodically and built from new straight through to the medieval period. And there's even a handful that are used as kind of layered or lordly homes into the post-medieval period as well. They aren't particularly well understood due to the difficulties in excavating them underwater and in waterlogged conditions. And the bulk of what we know really comes from two things. Antiquarian excavation, and really, by and large, one-off radiocarbon dates. So this map shows you they're very widely distributed across the country. There's probably now over 600 known or possible examples recorded. And if you went and surveyed every lock in the country, I think you could conservatively double or triple that number in terms of the amount of known sites. And as I mentioned, much of what we know about them really comes from these one-off radiocarbon dates, and this map shows all the radiocarbon data examples. By and large, the vast majority of these just have one or two radiocarbon dates. And there's not a whole lot that really tells us, other than that the Cranach was in use at one time. And on these multi-period, multi-phase sites that get used and reused across millennia, these one-off radiocarbon dates are frequently not particularly helpful. They're helpful in the first instance, and then the limit of what they can tell you really ends quite quickly. The sites that have been excavated, by and large, the majority antiquarian excavations, with the exception of Robert Munro's work, mostly in southwest Scotland, these are poorly recorded. So most of the black dots you see on this map, we just know that the site was excavated, and not much more about that. The sites that have been excavated more recently, and I'm very happy to say quite few have been excavated recently, these tend to be very, very small scale in nature. We're talking test pits of kind of 2 by 2 meters and not much more. And the majority of those are terrestrial. And when you drain the lock around the ground, you lose much of that stratigraphic information. The weight of the water is actually holding up the weight of the crown. And when you remove the water, everything gets compressed. So the importance of underwater excavation really can't be overstated in understanding how these sites form and what's going on them. There are a handful of Cranachs that have been excavated underwater and excavated relatively extensively. But even here, we run into the problem of chronology. And that is because underwater, there's really nothing other than the odd artifact find that comes up. There's really nothing to distinguish the layers from each other. The preservation is so good in the cold, dark waters that everything effectively looks the same. Well-preserved timber from the early Iron Age looks like well-preserved timber from the early medieval period, looks like well-preserved timber from the medieval period. And so you end up relying on radiocarbon dates, and you radiocarbon date different phases that you can identify stratigraphically, and you end up with something like this, and this looks pretty good. This is from Edderline Crown in Loch Awe. And you maybe eyeball sort of four phases of use here, three or four phases of use. And this is really the best that we could do, by and large, with the exception of dendrochronology, which is problematic, and I'll explain in a minute. So that brings us on to Lotte, the project that we're doing. So we're coming at this very much from problematizing this chronological issue. We know that crinoids emerged sometime in the period 800 to 400 BC, and there's a lot of evidence for that in the form of radiocarbon dates. But this period, due to a quirk in the way that radiocarbon dating works, is very difficult to get at, and that is because of our calibration, how we calibrate radiocarbon dates to the amount of C14 that we know was in the atmosphere at any one time. And what happens in the period 800 to 400 BC is we have what's known as the Hallstatt Plateau, where effectively something is not specifically known what, but probably to do with solar output, causes C14 to spike and then rebound back to kind of more normal levels and then level off. And in the period 800 to 400 BC, the effect is this smearing of a calibration of individual radiocarbon dates. In essence, we can't really do much with these radiocarbon dates other than say, at some point between 800 and 400 BC, that event occurred. So it's important to keep that in mind, that all these radiocarbon dates from Lochte crinoids, are indicating a single event, a single felling of one tree, really. These are all from structural timbers on the crinoids. But we can't say at what point within those some probability distributions. Right. So just to sort of illustrate that, here you have the radiocarbon measurement on the left, and this is the sum probability distribution. And in the period 800 to 400 BC, that distribution gets smeared across the whole period. And if you look at dates from other periods, you'll see a much tighter calibration, and that has to do with the underlying curve, which is this kind of river floating in the background. So there's the measurement, and then it falls down onto your sum probability distribution. So this is what we're coming up against in developing a method to sort of see through that. Sort of real world example, we have two crinoids in Lotte, Oakbank and Fearnan, about 150, 200 meters apart. Oakbank, we have a series of radiocarbon dates, single one-off radiocarbon dates, they all sort of calibrate to this 800, 400 period. Fearnan, we have a couple radiocarbon dates, same thing, but there's nothing to say between these. These might be two crinoids occupied at the same time, they might be two crinoids occupied 300 years apart. With no knowledge of the people who occupied one to the other. And that has, and this is where we get to kind of the meat of the problem, the archaeological problem, is understanding these sites in their landscape. You know, what is the landscape of Lotte like? Are we looking at a bunch of crinoids all occupied at the same time in the early Iron Age? Or are we looking at one or two with sort of phases of use separated by decades or centuries? And the people who built them may or may not have had any knowledge of each other. Basically, are we looking at a busy crinoid landscape or a very dispersed crinoid landscape? Our approach really is to target the sites that we know have early Iron Age dates. There's nine of them, we've looked at six. And what we're doing is we're using that excellent preservation to our advantage. It's often spoken about as a problem, or it kind of becomes a goal unto itself, i.e. let's find the really well-preserved stuff because it looks cool. We're trying to use it to our advantage. And this is really, because we're looking at the early Iron Age, this is the period, at least in Lotte, as far as we can tell, that crinoids first are used. And then that's going to give us an idea of how busy that landscape is, that social history of the early Iron Age. And the early Iron Age in this region is almost entirely known through the work that's been done on crinoids. There's not much terrestrial archaeology that could date to this period, out with hut circles in the upslope from the loch and a handful of possible or likely later prehistoric terrestrial sites. So we're using that really incredible preservation. This is a good photo. This is actually an early Iron Age axe mark or adze mark. And this is a very, very common find. Virtually every timber that we come across will have the tool marks still preserved on. so we're really using oak bank excavations that have been ongoing since about 1980 as a guide. The work there, much of what we're doing was kind of first sketched out at Oak Bank in terms of excavating underwater, as well as some of the dendrochronology that Aaron Crone did back in the 1980s. And Oak Bank has kind of been the center of what we're doing, including as well being the first primate to see a wiggle match date. So this is our way of overcoming the issue in dendrochronology. I'll just flip back a second. So the issue we have with dendrochronology in Scotland is that there's really no master chronology. So you can find plenty of timber to the dendro date, but the problem is that there just haven't been enough, particularly oak timbers, sampled throughout the country that would be able to develop a master chronology, so that when you find oak timber on a crono, you could say it was felled to a calendar date, as dendrochronology is able to do. But what we can do is develop floating chronologies. So we can relate the timbers to each other and say that one group here was felled maybe 20 years or so before another group over here. And that's what we're doing with the project. And this is what was done by Anne in the 1980s with the Oak Bank and something. So to overcome that and to put a calendar date to these floating chronologies, these groups of timbers that are just kind of in chronological space, we're doing wiggle match dating. And as I said, it was first carried out at Oak Bank. And what that is essentially just a series of radiocarbon dates that are taken through an individual timber in groups of rings. Because so rings 1 to 5, 6 to 10, 11 to 15, and so on through the whole tree. And what that does is it gives us a statistical framework on which to hang those summed probability distributions. And we can tell statistical software that rings 1 to 5 grew 5 years before rings 6 to 10, and so on through the tree. And that brings our error margins down from that plus or minus 200 years over the Hallstatt Plateau, down in some cases to plus or minus 20 or 10. So the result from that wiggle match that was done about 10 years ago at Oak Bank gave a result that one timber from Oak Bank date was felled sometime between 500 and 450 BC. So I'll just take you through a quick highlight of what we've been doing with the Living on Water project over the last 2 years. We've excavated 9 2x2 meter trenches over 6 different sites, targeting those sites that had the one-off really Iron Age dates, which I will hasten to add is not to say that the black dots here don't have early Iron Age phases. They've just not been dated yet, or potentially don't have them. We've sampled lots of timbers. We've developed those floating chronologies, or I should say Aaron Crone has developed those floating chronologies. We've got an early wiggle match dating to sort of 700, 650 BC, but we need to take that with a pinch of salt. There's more work to be done on dating that timber, adding more dates to the wiggle effectively. And it's just a single timber. So there is a chance that it's residual. The loch preserves timber very well. If there was a timber kicking about in the loch, there's nothing to say that it wasn't necessarily incorporated in the timber. So we'll take that with a grain of salt for now. But what we definitely have that is absolutely clear is this pulse of crown building right around 400 BC. A lot of our wiggle matches are coming back towards the end of the Hallstatt Plateau around 400 BC. So we've been underwater, about 10 weeks of underwater excavation so far across the six sites. And of course, we've come across this fantastic preservation, lots and lots of timbers. This timber came off Cragan Crannog. It was so fresh, it smelt like fresh sawn wood. And it's 2,500 years old, we think. We'll have the range finding date of that shortly. We've been doing a technique called photogrammetry, underwater photogrammetry. So you may have heard about this. It's becoming sort of a standard methodology in underwater archaeology. It really expedites the process of recording. You just simply take a lot of photographs over your target and create a very accurate 3D model that can then be put into actual 3D space using GPS coordinates. Fantastic preservation goes beyond the structural timbers and the occasional artifact. The paleoenvironmental information is outstanding, and what we're getting getting is so far there doesn't seem to be too much change through the early Iron Age. Now that might just be a fact that because we're getting this pulse of cryo activity around 400, effectively we're sampling activity all of roughly the same age. So we're not yet seeing a sort of change in the types of species and the types of economic activity indicating the paleoenvironmental remains yet. But what we are seeing is the whole landscape changes. We have arables, they're growing cereals. We have grazing evidence in the form of sheep droppings, as well as the sheep remains themselves. They're using plant remains from throughout the landscape, from near to the waterside, right up into the high upland areas, cloudberry, these seeds here. Only grow above sort of 500 meters OD. So either the sheep are going up into that area and bringing the cloudberries back in their droppings, or the people themselves are moving up into that area. Whether crown dwellers or not, somehow this material that is 400 meters above the surface of the loch is getting down to the crowns. And I would just highlight as well, this all came out of 1.5 liters of sample. The preservation is absolutely. So underwater again, finds are infrequent. What we found, or what was found at Oakbank, was that the finds tend to cluster in specific areas. These Iron Age people seem to be relatively clean, and so unless you pop your small trench directly over the area where you're clustering the artifacts, you're not going to find them. And this is a pattern that was also repeated at Blacklock. Spent 3 years digging this lochside village. And Aon Crone and Graham Cavers, who were directing it, only in the last season came across an area where they found a whole rash of artifacts. So this seems to be a pattern now at Oakbank and Blackwell, where the artifacts seem to cluster in specific areas. So it's unsurprising then that as part of the Living on Water project, we've not actually come across many artifacts. And really, the only organic artifact that we found is this pine taper, effectively an Iron Age candle. Really resinous wood burns kind of one end to the other. And a cornerstone that was sort of in the crown of mound itself, quite a nice, obvious artifact to come across as well. So I'll take you through the result that we got from Milton Mornish. This has been one of the more exciting results because of the real precision that we were able to achieve with this. Excavated this in 2017. It had these two 800 to 400 BC dates. Not much to tell between the two. We excavated a 2x2 trench at the base of the crown of mound, sampled most of the oak timbers that you see here in the darker brown, as well as a few alder timbers. Aon Crone had a look at those oak timbers, and three of them were felled in the same late winter, early spring. By measuring the tree rings, and the preservation was so good, was able to determine that. And a wiggle match date on one of those three timbers, timber 104, returned a result, this result here, which suggested that the timber was felled sometime between 370 and 355 BC. So really getting fantastic precision on the basis that this result actually fell just off the Hallstatt Plateau. So what happened was is the outermost rings were calibrating 400 to 200 BC, while the innermost rings were calibrating 800 to 400 BC. There's nowhere else for that result to go but 400 BC, if that's making sense. So, what is this doing for us across the loch? Well, we've gone from this totally unordered group where within a site and across sites, we're not able to make much sense. Any of these could be falling anywhere 800 to 400 BC. So how busy is this crown landscape? Are we talking one or two crowns occupied at the same time, or all the crowns occupied at the same time? The answer is potentially a bit of both. We definitely have crowns in use around the same time, just at 400 or just after 400 BC. At the three sites we looked at in 2017, Milton Mornish, Dal South, and Oakbank, all three of them have this kind of right around 400 BC phase. We've also got this, as yet, slightly anomalous, very early date represented Dalbe Sal. Take that with a grain of salt. And what we're also finding is that these 400 to 200 dates have sort of suddenly come into focus. There are a number of other crackers that we had not targeted initially because they had one-off radiocarbon dates calibrating the 400 to 200 BC. Now that we're falling off the plateau right around 400, there's every possibility that those one-off 400 to 200 dates would, upon wiggle match, move back towards 400. So we're really getting a pulse of activity right around that time. So the implications for this. This is a relatively new methodology. No individual element of this work is brand new. Wiggle matching has been around for 50 years, dendrochronology for 40. But bringing it all together and looking at a group of crinoids in this way is absolutely new. You're pulling out some really interesting things about the nature of crinoid dwelling because of it. In particular, of course, for the chronology. We can say for the first time, with absolute confidence, early Iron Age crinoids in Lotte are virtually certainly in use at the same time. More than one crinoids that are within sight of each other. The people who are using them undoubtedly knew each other, at least had some kind of contact with each other. And that's a real paradigm step forward. The other thing that's coming out of this, with the exception of our anomalous early wiggle to 700 to 650 BC, is we're coming up with this pattern that there does not seem to be any suggestion of settlement around Lotte, and indeed more widely across Scotland, in the period kind of 800 to 600 or 800 to 500 BC. Crinoids have always been kind of pointed to as a potential settlement, a type that could date to that period. But so far, all the wiggle match and dendrochronological dating information we have from crinoids is moving their initial Iron Age use to 500 to 400, really 500 at the earliest by and large. And so this has left me sort of scratching my head, you know, what settlements are in use 800 to 500 BC? And there really are not many that you can point to, certainly not many that you can point to on the basis of absolute dating. There's a handful of sites that have artifacts that you maybe push the use of the site into that period. But in terms of absolute dating, there's very, very few sites that you can confidently put to 800, 600, or 800, 500 BC. And so this is also because of the lack of terrestrial archaeology in the area. Our whole window on the early Iron Age of this part of Perthshire is via the crinoids and really via Oak Bank and the excavation and assemblage there. So this is prompting questions about what's going on. Are we looking at a landscape that is occupied only via crinoid in the early Iron Age? Is that the only settlement that's taking place at this time? Or is this simply a question of archaeological visibility? The other early Iron Age stuff was perhaps more slightly constructed, and then removed through later land use, whether that was later Iron Age settlement on top of it, masking it, or cleared through improvement. And we've been trying to answer this through geophysical prospection, which we undertook last month, well, 2 months ago now, and the results there were very much equivocal. There's nothing really obvious in the immediate landscape onshore from the crinoids that we could identify through MAG survey. So that's definitely something for further work, as well as testing the known record that is there in terms of potentially early Iron Age settlement sites that are reported. And that is where I think I will end things. Thank you very much for having me come speak today. I'll be happy to take